is Jeff Liebman. I'm a professor at the Harvard Kennedy School, and I'm the director of the Taubman Center for State and Local Government. And in about 2 weeks, I will also be the director of the Rappaport Institute for Greater Boston. And it's a pleasure to welcome you here today to this conference on policy and research partnerships in the digital age. We're going to hear about some extraordinary work that's already going on in public safety and education and data infrastructure, neighborhood development, and several other issues. But more importantly, we're going to create a space in which new partnerships can form today. In my career, I've spent 5 years in government and 15 years as a professor, and so I've seen these partnerships from both sides. And I've seen some incredibly fruitful projects get done. I've seen a couple that have crashed and burned. But mostly I've seen opportunities that never actually quite happened, missed opportunities. And I think there are a couple reasons why a lot of missed opportunities have occurred, why people never got introduced to the people they needed to get introduced to and never had the conversations they needed to have. But I mean, one thing I've seen is that it takes a lot of patience and goodwill on both sides to get these collaborations to happen. When I've been in government, I've time and time again seen people come in from the academy with thinking they had a good idea and try to sell something to government that the agency had already done 3 years before and that you could already find on the agency's website. And your instinct when you're in government and that happens is to say, oh my God, these professors are out of touch. They don't have any idea what's going on in government. But you should sort of overcome that instinct if you can, because what you should really think is, hey, here's a pretty talented person who's trying to help us, and you know, the right response is, well, that idea probably won't work, but here are three other things that I need help on, and any chance you can help us with any of those three things. And on, from when I've been in the university, I've seen a number of times where students or faculty members approached a government agency with a neat idea, and either they never got a response, or the response felt like the person who was responding was spending about 10 times as much energy coming up with different ways to say no rather than trying to see if there was a way to make something happen. Or someone found a middle-level person who was really enthusiastic about this idea, but they could never get sign-off from the person above them to actually move forward. And the instinct when you get that kind of reaction and you're coming approaching government from a university is to think, you know, this is another piece of evidence, you know, to play into the stereotypes of government being dysfunctional or inept. But in general, what's usually actually happening is that the people you're approaching are incredibly understaffed and overworked. They're dealing with some really key public crisis at the moment, and often, frankly, the thing you're bringing to them is not solving a problem that's on their top 15 list. And if that's true, they actually shouldn't be allocating their resources and their precious time to you rather than something on there that is on that list. And so when you come and approach government from the academy, having some understanding that you don't have enough visibility always to know whether you know, your priority really is going to turn out to be something that is a good allocation of public sector resources, or frankly, whether someone who has more visibility into the implementation issues and into the political trade-offs involved should in fact decide to move forward on something. And so I think both sides, you know, understanding, you know, it's hard to build the understanding that leads to these partnerships. And what it really takes is I think to get more of these off the ground is two things. It's more trust, which mostly comes from people knowing each other, and it's better information flow so that people in the academy can actually know what the top priorities and problems are that need help solving, and so that people within government can know what some of the skill sets and interests and modeling capabilities there are out in the universities that can help them. So I'm incredibly excited about today's event because it can build some of those relationships and cause some of that information flow to happen. But really, even more important, I think, than this event today is really the institutions that have sprung up over the last decade that are really working every day and trying to make these collaborations occur. There's the Boston Area Research Institute that Chris Winship and Rob Sampson have set up is just doing incredible work in solving these problems of trust and relationship building and information flow to allow tremendous partnerships to occur. Similarly, the Rappaport Institute that Ed Glaser has been running for the last decade has done a tremendous amount to foster these kinds of relationships, and the executive directors of both of those institutions deserve tremendous thanks for setting up today's event, David Lubarosh and Steve Poftek, but also for all the work they've been doing to build these partnerships over the past almost a dozen years. When I look at these partnerships that have been emerging, what's I think particularly exciting about them is that it's not just one university doing these things. They really are drawing upon all the universities in the Boston area and working on these connections between government and universities. It's terrific that the Rappaport Fellows program is not, even though it may be housed at one or two places, it's not limited to students from those places, and we draw fellows from all the graduate students from all of the universities in the Boston area and help place them in summer internships in governments in this area. The other thing that's extraordinarily exciting is the student energy around all of this. If you've looked at your program and seen the incredible student projects that are being presented this afternoon at the poster session, you can get a sense of all the energy. And if you look more carefully at the speaker list and the people in government speaking, a lot of them were former students from a lot of these institutions. And so these pipelines that are helping talented people from the universities see how exciting and challenging government work is and giving them a route into city government and state government has just been incredibly, I think, powerful in setting the preconditions for broader collaborations to occur. But the final thing I just want to say is one of the things I think that is motivating today's session is that the fact that IT progress, data availability has occurred over the last 20 years and is increasingly a tool of government is something that is making this a really important time to get as many of these collaborations to happen as possible, because a lot of the people in the academy have particularly strong skills in data analysis and statistics and modeling of a sort that is particularly critical and particularly a large opportunity for government right now. And so I think a lot of what makes the fact that these institutions I referred to have started to build these partnerships over the last decade, but will be able to build even more important partnerships over the next decade, is that this is the time where we most need those partnerships because of the advances in data availability and information technology. So that's most of what I want to say. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Lizabeth Cohen, the Dean of the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study and the Howard Mumford Jones Professor of American Studies at Harvard University. Liz has been a leader in Harvard's efforts to develop a broader interdisciplinary approach to urban problems, something that I think is exemplified in today's event, because you can see that the people from the universities, the various universities who are here today, cross fields from economics, history, sociology, public policy, urban planning, statistics, psychology, evolutionary biology, and I probably missed a couple. But there really is an effort to have there be a real interdisciplinary approach to tackling some of these issues, and Liz has really been leading that effort.
So, great. Thank you, Jeff, for that nice introduction, and hello, everybody. And my thanks for joining us today to help explore policy and research collaborations in Boston. As Jeff told you, I'm Liz Cohen. I'm Dean of the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study, which is a co-sponsor of today's conference. Our topic today is such an important and apparently popular subject for our city and region that we had to close registration before Thanksgiving. I'm very pleased to extend my welcome to those of you who are assembled here in District Hall and to many viewers who I think will be watching us elsewhere on the live webcast. And just so you know and can share the news with others who might not have been able to join us today, we are recording today's panels so that others can later share in what we will all learn here today. Today's discussions have the power to shape how we use information and data to understand and improve cities. That mission is what brings us all together, whether we work for the city of Boston or a nearby municipality, whether we teach at, and I'm going to tell you all of the schools that are represented here, UMass, BU, BC, Suffolk, MIT, Emerson, Northeastern, Harvard, or Tufts, or another local school, or are employed at one of the many foundations or other nonprofits in the greater Boston area who are represented at today's symposium. We all share a strong collaborative commitment to this mission, and I look forward to welcoming new colleagues to join us in this effort during the years ahead. Jeff Liebman will surely be an energetic and worthy successor to Ed Glaser, who is stepping down, as you heard, as head of the Rappaport Institute. Key members of Mayor Marty Walsh's team were deeply involved in planning today's events, just as Mayor Thomas Menino's support for data-driven research partnerships had been instrumental to so many projects, including the Boston Area Research Initiative and the Boston University Initiative on Cities. I know we're all looking forward to hearing from Mayor Walsh later today as he shares his thoughts about how new data can make Boston and its neighboring cities and towns better environments in which to live and to work. I feel personally connected to our charge today to probe the topic, and I take here from the title, Understanding and Improving Cities. As a new dean of the Radcliffe Institute in the fall of 2011, I was delighted to participate in a conference at Radcliffe that was called Reimagining the City-University Connection, Integrating Research Policy and Practice. Out of that day, there was a day-long symposium, grew the Boston Area Research Initiative, jointly organized by Radcliffe, the Rappaport Institute, and the City of Boston, and that the BARI, as we call it, is a co-organizer of our conference today. In addition, I'm a 20th century U.S. urban historian, and I have a deep interest in understanding how today's urban centers developed out of decisions that were made in the recent past. I'm currently writing a book on the urban renewal of American cities from the 1950s through the 1980s. And I think there's much we can learn from the experiments and the mistakes that were made in that period of intense urban redevelopment after World War II, when suburbanization seemed to be shaping the nation's future. Faced with that challenge, urban renewers of the time made a similar commitment to exploring the link between theory and practice, research and policy, though with very different approaches than prevail today. We've come together for this conference because, like those predecessors decades ago, we care about cities, we want to improve them, and we recognize that research and implementation must go hand in hand. We are fortunate in Boston to have access to great data. We also have access to great analytical tools and to great minds in the academic, government, and private sectors. Our challenge, then, is to figure out how, from the rich data and human resources available to us, we can frame problems, amass information, and reach conclusions that will make this city and others like it more livable, more equitable, and more sustainable for today and far into the future. I have to confess that I have very high hopes. We have benefited from a key part of Major Menino's vast legacy, and I think we have excellent prospects under Mayor Walsh's dynamic new leadership. And we have a number of committed partners with which to share these challenges. And I'd like to introduce to you now one of those partners, Mary Jo Meisner, who is Vice President for Communications, Community Relations, and Public Affairs at the Boston Foundation. Prior to joining the Boston Foundation in 2001, Mary Jo had a long career in journalism, and she has had extensive experience on civic and academic boards. So it's now my pleasure to turn the podium over to her.
Good morning, everyone. I bring greetings from the Boston Foundation, which is very proud to sponsor this important conference. We believe passionately in the power of high-quality data to help people make informed decisions about issues affecting our cities, and particularly the city that we all love, Boston. Around our office, we're very fond of quoting former New York Mayor Michael Bloomberg, who once said, "In God we trust, everyone else bring data." Many of you know something about our organization, but for those of you that don't, let me just give you a tiny bit of background. The Boston Foundation is Greater Boston's community foundation. We have assets that recently passed $1 billion. It's one of the largest community foundations in the country, and it's also one of the oldest. We're pleased and privileged that starting January 1st, we will be celebrating our 100th anniversary. We have lots of activities planned and hope to see many of you at them. In addition to being a major grant maker, for which we are known, and helping our donors with high-impact philanthropy, we also serve as a civic leader for Greater Boston. And that aspect of our work is really the newest one. When Paul Grogan first became president of the foundation in 2001, there was a sense, a real strong sense, that there was a leadership vacuum in the city of Boston that had to do with lots of the corporate consolidations that were occurring and other issues. And our board at that time thought that the Boston Foundation, despite the fact that it is playing this very key role in grant making and in philanthropy, could really step out more and help fill a vacuum in terms of civic leadership. So Paul hired me, and we set out to develop what we think is one of the key civic leadership models for foundations in the country. And one of the first things we did and gave us a sense of credibility in this area was to take what had been an incredible initiative at the Boston Foundation, the Boston Indicators Project, but was not truly very well known at that point. We had launched it in the 1990s, not me and Paul, but others, as one of the first indicators projects in the country, and it had we've always worked in strong partnership with the City of Boston and the Metropolitan Area Planning Council, but it had been somewhat on the radar screen. So as Paul and I like to say, we brought it out of the attic, we brought it down to the living room, and it has become really part of our entire model of working on civic leadership in the city. Since that Paul arrived, we've published 11 major reports in the Indicators Project, and we have created an award-winning interactive website. But it has also become a key foundational piece for how we do our work overall. So in 2002, we launched what we call our Understanding Boston model of research. And through that model, we have worked with a number, virtually all of the academic think tanks, universities, and private think tanks, almost all of the entities that are in the room today that we are celebrating as part of BARI, to commission and present what we think is just top-notch, high-quality research over the last 13 years. We've done 126 reports in conjunction with our partners, and they have included everything from an annual housing report card, numerous reports on K-12, higher education, sweeping studies of the cultural and nonprofit sectors, and research into a whole range of things, ranging from transportation to a really profound set of reports that we did with the Greater Boston Rappaport Institute on home rule. The research we commissioned really is directly connected to the role we play in wanting to help develop public policy and legislative strategies and in creating coalitions to move that. So we're in the business of data and information, but we're also in the business of seeking to drive change and systems change. There's so many of them, I'm not going to kind of walk through them, but I will say that one special effort that we're quite proud of, and you'll hear Elizabeth Polly, from who's our Senior Director of Education, talk about later in the program, is the work that we did to really help bring about the Achievement Gap Act of 2010, which was signed by Governor Patrick on Martin Luther King Day in 2010. And it's given students across the state greatly expanded access to high-quality K-12 schools, including opening more charter schools and giving other schools the same kind of autonomies that are so important to bring about high-quality things. That was a direct outgrowth of a series of education reports that we did. And it shows the tremendous power that data and information combined with coalition building and partnership can have in our very significant community. And that's really just one part of what we see about this whole effort, though. The other is really this ability, the powerful tool of partnership, which is a major theme of this conference. The Indicators Project could not do its work. We could not at the Boston Foundation play this role without so many of you in the room. We are blessed in our city, in our region, to have this network of just supremely high quality think tanks, academic research institutions. We're so pleased to be able to work with you and to continue to do that. So I know today we'll provide a terrific platform for examining the power of partnership and collaboration and to see what else we can be doing. I do want to say next year, in addition to celebrating our centennial, we are going to be holding a series of major events, and the first one is a conference on January 27th that I would like to invite all of you to, called The Shape of the City. There's information that will be going out soon about that. I have all of your email addresses, so I will be inviting you. And I promise you that the dialogue that day will be well-grounded in data from the Indicators Project, but from all of you as well. So now I'd like to turn things over to our good friend, our colleague, Chris Winship, who is the Diker Tishman Professor of Sociology at Harvard and is the co-director of BARI to really take off on our first panel, Partnerships in Public Safety.
This conference is about partnerships, and I just should say BARI is part of a group of cities, New York, London, and Chicago, and one of our meetings, first meetings, they kept talking about clients, and we kept telling them they were wrong. They needed to start talking about partnerships. I think it's particularly appropriate that we're starting with talking about public safety for two reasons. One, obviously, it's a very important topic of considerable public concern. But second, because there's a really long history in Boston of various institutions, the police and the DA's office, you know, working with community groups, foundations, including, most importantly, our sponsor, the Boston Foundation, but also academics, and in very deep and extensive ways. So certainly for many, many years, the police department and other criminal justice organizations have worked with different faculty, at Northeastern in particular. And then starting in the 1990s, there's a group at the Kennedy School working primarily with Youth Violence Task Force as part of the ceasefire program and sort of what generally then becomes known as the Boston Miracle. And probably should say just a bit about, though I hope Dan's going to tell us a lot more, what is the Boston Miracle? Well, at least if we're doing it in numbers, it's two numbers. In the 1980s, homicide rates go down 80%. And at the same time, complaints against the police department go down 60%. This has made Boston a model in the country for how to do community-friendly policing, how to partner with community institutions to deal with the difficult problems of things like gang violence. So these partnerships go all the way back to mid-90s, so they're essentially 20 years old at this point. They continue. There is, different people, different institutions have been added to the mix here. But I think it's an enormously important model for how cities, police departments, and DA offices in particular can work with local partners, and including universities and researchers. So we have a distinguished panel today, and I'm going to just briefly tell you who they are. I'm only give you their titles, in fact, because we've been told you can read, and you should just look at the bios. So we're going to start off with Dan Mulhern, who's the Director of Public Safety Initiatives in the Mayor's Office, but formerly from the DA's office. And then we're going to have Brenda Bond, who's a professor of public service, that's a new title, at the Sawyer Business School at Suffolk. And then we're going to have Cynthia Rudin, who's a professor at MIT and is head of their prediction lab. Then we're going to ask Dan to kind of come back and sort of pull it together. We will then have a discussion among the panel members. And after that, we'll open the floor up to questions from the audience. So Dan, please.
Good morning, everyone.
Come up here if you'd like.
Yeah, I have a lot of difficulty sitting in a chair. I have two little ones at home, so very rarely am I stationary in my personal life. Let me tell you a little bit about myself so I can give you some context to my remarks. So prior to coming to join Mayor Walsh in March of this year, I worked for the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office and had been a prosecutor for about 13 years. Most of that time I spent in Suffolk County in the gang unit. And for the last 7 or 8 of my years working for District Attorney Dan Conley, I was the chief of the gang unit. The gang unit is responsible for essentially supervising, evaluating, and overseeing all the firearm violence in the city of Boston. So in my function as a chief of that unit, every firearm arrest that took place in Suffolk County would get sent to me to review and make a decision about what lawyers should prosecute that case and where it should be prosecuted. I also reviewed all of those firearm cases and any gang-involved arrests with the United States Attorney's Office and spent 3 years as a Special Assistant United States Attorney prosecuting some gang cases in federal court also. And then for probably the last 6 or 7 years at the District Attorney's Office, my primary caseload that I kept as a head of that unit were gang-related murders in the city. Supervised a team of about 10 or 11 other lawyers and advocates and investigators. And then during the course of that, had really gotten to know Mayor Walsh well in his past life. And I hadn't met to date a public servant that was more committed to thinking outside of the box about how we could really look at the violence in the city from a more holistic and an organic fashion, how we could partner with our community partners, probably many of whom are in the room, our philanthropic partners, seeing Mary Jo in the front row, and our academic partners to really look at the problem and be hopeful about the solutions we could come up with. So that's the context. We'll talk a little bit about the Boston Miracle. I'll talk about where we are today as best that I can tell in terms of the landscape for the gang violence. Boston, born and raised here also in the city of Boston. While I was a prosecutor in Suffolk County and Superior Court, I had a family member murdered in the city of Boston and ultimately solved and tried in Suffolk Superior Court to a not guilty. So also provided me with a bit of a different perspective on some of the issues that we're talking about today. Many of you have heard quite a bit about the Boston Miracle. And for those of you that are from Boston, you probably have a sense that Boston looked very, very different back at that time. We had crack cocaine burst into our city like it did nationally. And as a result of crack cocaine bursting into our city, the gang dynamic was very different. There were fewer gangs, larger gangs, and there was a business enterprise on some level attached to the activity on the street. Recognizing, and please, I don't want to offend anyone in the room, recognizing one homicide is too many, one shooting is too many in any of the conversations that we have. Back at the time of the Boston Miracle, it was easier for law enforcement to evaluate the conflict. And it was easier for law enforcement to look at it in a much more pragmatic way. It was a bit more predictable. There were fewer groups, larger, and if there was a shooting on one side of the equation, it would be very likely that there would be retaliation on the other side of the equation. What many of the folks did at the time in the city of Boston is made a decision that law enforcement absolutely could not arrest and prosecute its way out of the problem. They made a very, very conscious decision that in order for us to be effective as a city and to be a healthy city and a safe city, in a city where all our residents could thrive, walk to the bus stop, go to school, go to church on a Sunday, that they all had to come together. And you all probably know that that coming together included all of our partners across the faith-based community, community agencies, the prosecutor's office, the law enforcement, both state and federal. We had great success at that time. And as we moved into my time at the district attorney's office and in my current position, the demographics of the landscape changed a little bit in the city of Boston. Law enforcement was extremely effective based on its partnerships at resolving some of the conflict in the city. But what we saw graduating into my time, I came to Suffolk County in 2002, I believe, 2002 or 2003, that we had a much larger number of groups in the city that were identifying themselves as gangs. We had a much larger number of groups with fewer being part of those groups. Our numbers in terms of gang-involved young people in the city, both male and female, grew, but it was divided up in a far higher number. And that created for all of us in the room, including our academic partners, some additional challenges. Because when I go back to the Boston Miracle and understanding maybe some of the conflict and where to look when there was one shooting on one side of the conflict and where the next one may be, with this larger number of groups and with smaller numbers, it made it a bit more confusing for us because those smaller groups would collaborate with other smaller groups, strengthen numbers. But when they did that, and they currently do that, they would assume the conflicts and the friendships of the other groups. So the conflict wasn't as we sit here today, not as clearly defined in the city. Back when I started in the district attorney's office, and I know this is going to make little sense to anyone, but you wouldn't see many people shot on a Sunday. You wouldn't see, generally speaking, families involved in potential crossfire. You wouldn't see females really involved in the violence. For lack of a better term, there was some predictability, right, to when and where and what times of day some of the shootings may happen. And if you asked any researcher in this room or any academic partner now, when they try to look at data from years past and predict when and how to assist us as a city and as a law enforcement agency around deployment, where we should be at places, when we should be there, you'll find there's absolutely no method to the madness. That shootings are occurring at random hours on every day of the week. There was a time when there was some sense of rules to who you would fire at and where they were and whom they were with. We've seen a change in that. We've seen in the city, I think it was last year at one point, leading up to July or August when I was still at the district attorney's office, a very large number of young women that were caught in the crossfire and hurt as a result of some of the shootings in the city. And so when we talk about our partnerships in here and how data and information may assist us in moving forward, we have a lot more challenges now than we did at the time of the Boston Miracle. I'm happy to report, given the landscape of the country right now, I'm so happy to report that we're in the hands of a mayor and a police commissioner who, if nothing else, have opened every door possible to every type of conversation about working together and looking at the root causes. If we can't control that necessarily or predict the activity at the time when it's happening and deploy in a responsible fashion, We now have so many folks at the table trying to figure out, well, what's causing it to begin with? And that's where the research and the analysis of the research can be really helpful for us moving forward. There's so much for me to say about this and how it plays into reentry, how it plays into some of our concerns, the mayor's concerns and priority around human trafficking. When young people have points of entry to this type of activity, and when they enter into that type of activity, what does the trajectory look like, and what we can do as a city in partnerships and wrapping ourselves around them at the time most in need. So I think I've probably said enough for now, and I'm happy to come back after my fellow panelists speak.
So good morning. Thank you very much for having me, and thanks to the panelists and the conference organizers, and certainly to our hosts. My name is Brenda Bond. I'm on the faculty at Suffolk University, and I work in the Public Service Department, which is a department within the business school. I'm here to talk a little bit about my experiences and my observations being in a research partnership. So hopefully you'll learn some things and be entertained by some of the stories. I'd like to also acknowledge my friends from Boston PD and Lowell PD, and today I'm going to talk primarily about my work in Lowell, but I have worked in a number of different communities and with a number of different police departments. My particular interests and research is really driven by what I would call my first career, and my first career was actually working as director of research at the Lowell Police Department. I grew up in Massachusetts and spent most of my time early on working in Lowell. As a graduate student at UMass Lowell, I studied in I studied in criminal justice, but also in community social psychology. So much of my work with both practitioners and researchers is really driven by my appeal towards interdisciplinary understanding of the kinds of public safety challenges that face communities. I'm trained in community social psychology and social policy, and I feel like that offers some really interesting opportunities for public safety leaders and practitioners. So I'd like to talk primarily about my work in Lowell. I'm really interested in working in smaller cities. I've done a lot of work in Springfield, Mass, and in Lowell, and have done some work also in Boston, but I'm really attracted to some of these other cities that really do mirror bigger cities in a lot of ways in terms of their challenges, but just are, have really different kinds of dynamics. So I say on this slide that I have an insider-outsider perspective. I spent about 7 years working at the Lowell Police Department as a director of research, and that's really where I became exposed to this idea of researcher-practitioner partnerships. And I can say that as I look back on almost 20 years of working in public safety, I have had been involved in some really successful partnerships, but I've also been involved in what I would call some very interesting partnerships. And I think that's really informed the way that I approach the work that I do currently. So I have also had some really fantastic mentors in terms of learning about what it's like to partner, and that really informs the work that I do as a partner on the research side. I want to talk specifically about a couple of different concrete examples of the work that I have done. So again, I'm focused primarily on Lowell, but in my work there in Lowell, I've been serving. So when I left Lowell as a practitioner to go back to school, to graduate school, to do my PhD work, I had the opportunity to then work on a research project with a gentleman named Anthony Braga, who many of you know. And Anthony had approached me when I was in graduate school about working on a randomized controlled trial in Lowell. And I think that what he was thinking is that because I had a longstanding relationship with people in the Lowell Police Department, I had worked in the city of Lowell for a very long time, that I would have the opportunity to access individuals and people in the community and in the department in a way that researchers from outside could not always do. In that experience, I really learned that It's the relationship that really helps you to be successful. And I'll talk a little bit about that, because I find that my ongoing relationship with people in the community and in the department have really given me access. So currently I work on a federally funded project out of the Department of Justice with the Lowell Police Department. It's called the Smart Policing Initiative. And the initiative primarily is centered around using evidence and best practices to try to impact outcomes of interest. So in that work, which is called the SPI project, the Smart Policing Initiative, in that work, my role as a research partner is to do a couple things. First of all is to pay attention to process. What is it that the police department is actually doing in terms of trying to use research and use evidence, and how is that working out? What do officers in the field think about this idea of adopting research and using evidence in their practice? What are the kinds of challenges that arise in that process? What are the things that we can learn about taking big city approaches and trying to apply them in a smaller city that seems very different, or maybe has very different community dynamics or organizational factors that impact how evidence is implemented in a different context? I also have been involved in facilitating meetings and going out and doing focus groups with officers and sergeants. I'm currently involved in helping the department to develop an evidence-based leadership course for frontline supervisors. So my role in that project is both to pay attention to process, to help to sort out what it is about the research that is easily applied, or what is it about the context that makes it very difficult to apply the research. I also am using my professional network to help to bring subject matter experts into the city to help them understand and tackle different kinds of challenges. On the previous work that I mentioned that I worked with Anthony, we did a randomized controlled trial there. We participated in a lot of meetings. We worked with officers at the field level, but we also worked with managers and leaders on a regular basis to look at the data to say, on a monthly basis, how are we doing? What are we learning from the practice that we're applying, and how can we understand what are the next steps? So in a previous slide, I mentioned that a lot of my research approach is action research. It's trying to apply new ideas, trying to learn from that process to inform the policy and the practice going forward. And then lastly, another project that I've worked on both in Boston, Springfield, and Lowell is the Shannon Community Safety Initiative, which a lot of people here may know about. So I say that I offer these as examples because my involvement is really very different in each of these projects. And so there's a challenge in there that I need to be a generalist in some ways, but I also need to be somebody who can offer some reflection, bring that research, try to translate the research in a way that's helpful to the leadership. Just very briefly, because I know my time is short, but in this process specifically, just part of what I am also required to do is talk about results, to identify what it is that we're learning, what kind of impact are these particular programs having. And so when I speak about process, this is an example of one of the things that we were able to do in this particular project, which is to capture what it is about different research initiatives that seem to be making a difference. So not just paying attention to the practice on the street, but what's happening organizationally, what are the kinds of things that are happening within the organization that seem to be making a difference? How are we bringing people together from the street? How are we bringing those folks together with the leadership to have a discussion about implementation issues? And then also capturing the results. Clearly this is a difficult slide to read, but it is the responsibility of the research partner to identify outcomes and try to help the practitioners with honing in on the specific impact of the work. So trying to put those different things together. So the work that I do with practitioners and really trying to sort of be a boundary spanner between practice and research is really driven by what I believe are really important ideals. Open communication, a mutual benefit. What is it about the project that will be helpful to the practitioners, to the leadership, to the community, and how is it that that I can benefit in terms of learning and understanding and then informing the field as well? I have to be very open to learning. The benefit of me being a practitioner is that I am very well aware of contextual constraints, resource issues, staffing issues, leadership changes, and so therefore I must have patience and trust in the process. So I try to approach all of my partnerships with these ideas in mind. So my last slide is really just to point out that there are a lot of things I've learned maybe in the 20 years that I've been doing this on both sides, and that I have to enter into a relationship knowing that I don't know everything, but that we are hopefully both in it together to really make a difference. And I have to have a lot of patience. I'm in a very supportive academic institution in terms of allowing for those interesting projects to not always be as productive as possible, but again, some of the fundamental things that I think that we learn over time very much apply to those kinds of partnerships. So I'm happy to chat more about my experience and lessons as we move on. Thank you.
This is a joint work with Tong, who's my PhD student, who has a poster later, and Dan Wagner and Rich Saveri at the Cambridge Police Department. It's called Predictive Analytics for Crime Pattern Detection. So a crime series is a type of crime pattern that's defined as a group of similar crimes thought to be committed by the same individual or group of individuals acting in concert. And figuring out when they happen is a critical component of crime analysis because these patterns happen very often. So this is the 2012 Cambridge Police Department Annual Crime Report. And in that report, they talk about the crimes that have happened in Cambridge. So for instance, in 2012, there were 420 residential burglaries in 2012. And then they say very clearly that the effects of housebreak patterns were felt in almost every neighborhood in Cambridge this year, but particularly in Area 4, Cambridgeport, Peabody, and West Cambridge. At least two of these patterns were connected to juvenile crews out of Cambridge and Boston. And they even produce like a map of where all these crime patterns occur, and they tell you a little bit about each crime pattern and what the MO of the criminals were. Now the question that I have is, are the six crime series on the map the only crime series that happened in Cambridge that year? And the answer is, well, it's not really clear, because finding out all of these crime series is actually very challenging. You have to have a crime analyst who they try to detect these things every day. They sit there at a computer and they manually try to search through this database using SQL queries, trying to find these patterns of crime. So who knows if they found them all? So we said, all right, you know, this is great. So you've got this team of crime analysts sitting there trying to find these patterns of crime. Why can't we build a mathematical tool that will use machine learning that will help them find the patterns of crime automatically? So this is the database that the police department has, and they gave that database to us. So we have 7,067 housebreaks in Cambridge between the years of 1997 and 2011. They even told us 51 patterns of crime that actually occurred. And they keep very, very detailed data. I mean, the fact that they keep this kind of detailed data truly indicates how important this problem is to them. But we have all kinds of very detailed information about these crimes. We know the geographic location, the day of the week, the time of the day that it occurred, the time frame. We know how the person got in. We know, did they enter through the, you know, did they pry the door open? Did they shove it open? Did they force it open? Did they push in the air conditioner and come through the window? We know whether the place was ransacked. We know whether the residents were present during the break-in. So we have all that information, and we're trying to figure out which crimes were committed by the same people. So we designed these new machine learning approaches to try to help the police department locate crime series. The hard part for us is a computational problem. We don't know the MO of the criminal in advance. We don't know the modus operandi of the criminal. So for us, that means we have to look through all subsets, effectively, we have to look through all subsets of crimes and all possible MOs for these crimes, because we have to figure out not only the the series, but also the not only which crimes are in the series, but also the MO. If we don't know the MO, we can't find the crimes. If we don't know the crimes, we can't figure out the MO. So we have to look for them both at the same time. And we've been pretty successful at this in the sense that we've been able to match crimes to series that the Cambridge Police Department hadn't previously matched. So we would bring them these results, and we'd say, do these crimes belong in this series or not? And very often, they do belong in this series. And we've also been able to exclude crimes from series that they later agreed, indeed, these crimes were not part of the series. And there's a crime pattern on the screen here that really demonstrates that. I don't really have time to go into this particular crime pattern, but if you come to Tong's poster later, you can see what this pattern is. But it's a really neat pattern that we found that the Cambridge Police Department thought was two separate patterns. And we have now a lot of evidence to convince them that it's actually one single pattern. And we found this pattern even with a giant time gap in the middle of the series, like the criminals took a Christmas vacation and then came back. And they also changed locations. They actually started down here and then moved up to a couple of blocks, and we still were able to locate the crime series. So that's kind of a neat example. Now, I was asked also to comment at the end of my talk on research practitioner partnerships. And I have to provide a disclaimer, which is that the collaboration with the Cambridge Police Department is very unusual. So Dan Wagner, who's my collaborator, who leads the crime analysis unit, he came to me with a research paper on self-exciting point processes and said, I don't think this is the particular model we want to use for crime series detection. And I was like, whoa. And so I read the paper, and I was like, yeah, you're right. So I came up with another model, and he shut that one down, too. So Dan is a bit of an unusual collaborator. He's very, very mathematical. So that's unusual. In any case, so here are my advice for the researchers. So the researchers must become domain experts. That means you have to not come in with your own hammer and try to hit the problem with your hammer. You have to understand the problem and find the hammer or discover the new hammer that's right for that problem. We have to be solving problems that are fresh, possibly outside our own comfort zone. I had never done anything like this crime series detection problem before Dan came to me and said, hey, I want to work with you on this. We can't just take data and do something with it. Sometimes people want to give us data and they say, do something with this data. No, that doesn't work. What problem are we trying to solve with these data? Which data do we trust for this problem? How do we know what results are going to be useful to the practitioner? We need to talk to the practitioner and become experts ourselves. We also need to produce believable and trustworthy results. In the machine learning community, for many years, we've been selling black box models to practitioners. These are models that take data in, they do a very complicated function of the data, and spit out a predictive model. And practitioners are sometimes reluctant to use these models. So in my lab, we've been designing interpretable machine learning methods. And there's another poster by my student Fulton later today where he's talking about some non-black box models that we're developing, and we are planning to apply these to recidivism prediction, reoffender prediction. So we need to produce believable and trustworthy results. From the practitioner side, practitioners must invest their time and energy in the research project. They should plan to use the result. Don't waste the researcher's time. If you go to the researcher and have the researcher invest a ton of time in this project, and then they find out you weren't planning on using the results in the first place, that can be very, very heartbreaking. Also, choose projects that are truly research projects. Right? To me, if you give me a project and say, apply machine learning to this, that's not a research project. Any undergrad can do that. So it's got to be a research project. And then also, evaluation methods are important. So it can be very problematic if a researcher evaluates the quality of their method on data, and then the domain experts don't understand the evaluation procedure, and then they don't trust the result. So this can be very bad. So I suggest for the practitioners to learn scientific evaluation methods for evaluation of out-of-sample tests. Learn things like true positive rate and false positive rate.
So Dan, you have the opportunity to kind of start to weave this together, and then we can have a conversation
Sure.
among the four of us.
Sure. Yeah. So I'll do my best to do that. So Brenda's slide about kindergarten, I know this really dumbs it down and oversimplifies it, but data is enormously, enormously important to how we do business as a city, how we do business as in our respective law enforcement roles, how I evaluate my responsibility on behalf of the mayor. But if we dismiss the human factor, and to Brenda's point, I have seen it done over and over and over again, if we don't focus on the importance of the relationship, if we don't focus on the importance of contribution from both sides of the equation, we will never, ever be successful. That was the benefit of what happened when we talk about the Boston Miracle. That's the benefit of much of what is happening in City Hall these days and the city of Boston at this time. I'll give you a concrete example. Operation Ceasefire, something that came to play back in the 90s. When I described how the conflict was easier to see back in the 90s, what law enforcement did at that time, along with community partners, is said, look, let's bring in one side of the equation. We'll put prosecutors in the room, police in the room, and community service providers in the room, and we'll have a carrot and stick type of conversation. You better do the right thing or else. And the community providers and potential employment providers and healthcare providers would provide that other potential opportunity moving out of the life. As we moved forward and continued to use the ceasefire model, and myself being the face of ceasefire on behalf of the law enforcement side with the police department over the last 7 or 8 or 9 years, we realized because of the change in the demographics in Boston, it wasn't really an effective model on how we should do business today. And the mayor and our police commissioner, when they were interested in doing another ceasefire model, we all got together in a room, myself with the command staff, and said, look, that was a great tool then, but Boston has changed and we have to evolve with it. If we do not evolve with it, then we'll be unsuccessful. And the police department, the command staff, and most importantly, the mayor came up with a program called Operation Exit. We've talked a lot about it in the city, but we decided instead of bringing one side in against the other side, because harder to define now, based on what I talked to you about, smaller groups, lots of collaboration, conflict, so not necessarily linear all the time. We brought some young men and women in into a room at the Whittier Street Health Center from 16 or 17 different groups and put them in a room just like this and talked to them about the downside of how of their decision-making in our neighborhoods. And it was really, really, really service-heavy, opportunity-heavy. And the mayor made a request of our trade unions to be present in the room. We had 7 business agents from respective trade unions in the room talking to the young men and women about the opportunity that the trades provided to them in moving their lives forward. So meaningful opportunity, career potential. We talked about annuities. We talked about pension. We leveraged our relationship with the Street Safe program from the Boston Foundation and our street workers to get the young people into the room and looked at the problem differently. And I'm happy to say that we graduated our first program through the mayor of 16 participants in Operation Exit, and we are close to 100% placement in buildings right around where we are right now. Ultimately, when they complete their apprenticeship program, the average salaries are somewhere between $85,000 and $125,000 a year. So you're talking about life-changing opportunity, the opportunity to buy a home, to provide for your family, and move out of a type of behavior that presented a potential high risk. So I'll sit back down because I'm interested in some of the questions, but I can't stress enough both of my colleagues' emphasis on, look, law enforcement folks, as you know, when you've been pulled over, right? Not the easiest people to have conversations with at times, you know? And I could not be more pro-law enforcement. I come from a law enforcement family. And so you have to be artful in how you present your ideas, your research, your academic approach you have to be willing to listen. Because without the human factor, without the input of the boots on the ground, without the input of folks that are talking to young people in our neighborhoods and our residents, the data just, it won't make sense. And so the emphasis on those relationships, I think, is enormously crucial. So.
Thank you. So, Dan, in your earlier comments, you were talking about sort of how when violent crime occurs, time is random, who it's happening to seems to be random, hard to predict. And of course, I'm sitting over here looking at this woman from MIT who is the head of the prediction analytic lab, and I'm sort of, you know, wonder if she might talk briefly about, you know, what would you do to start trying to figure out whether there is something besides absolutely pure randomness going on. You only have to get the 1 or 2 minute one.
Sorry, to try to figure out whether there's something besides, you mean uniform randomness? I mean, I'm not.
He just used the word randomness. You and I could have the technical talk about, you know, sort of what did he exactly mean.
This is the danger of being in a room like this, right? You use the wrong word. I'll say harder to predict. Is that easier as opposed to random?
Yeah, let's just say Dan called you up and said, you know, we're trying to understand what's going on so we can try to intervene before we do proactive policing, which is a very important part of the Boston story, and identify, you know, people who are likely either to be perpetrators or victims of violence. Or perhaps it's about locations, or maybe it's the intersection of those two. You know, I think there's actually a bit of an analogy between what you were talking in Boston, which is Dan talked about how back in the 90s, if somebody got killed or somebody was shot, you kind of knew who was going to respond. Well, now it's complicated, but I think it's complicated in the same sense that what you're doing in Cambridge is complicated in terms of trying to find non-obvious patterns of response.
Yeah, I mean we're approaching it from two different angles, and the one that's more complicated is the one where you're trying to detect patterns that are already occurring. That's very complicated. And then the other angle, like that I was mentioning, is look at instead of looking at crimes that have occurred and trying to figure out which crimes have been committed by the same people, look at the people and try to figure out which ones are most likely to commit a crime. And we have two data sets for that. One is a giant recidivism data set from people who are released from prison in a particular year. And then the other data set we have is a survey of youth that were from three different states, youth that were raised in out-of-home care, and trying to predict whether they'll commit a crime within a three-year period. And those are the three projects we've been working on, essentially.
So Brenda, academics love comparative analysis. You've worked in several different cities. I'm kind of wondering sort of, you know, the differences, similarities. What do you learn from, you know, having worked in different places?
One thing that for me is really paramount is understanding sort of the contextual dynamics of the city and of the organization. So some cities I've worked in have a very long history of distrust between the community and the police department and political corruption. So many cities I've worked in have that problem, actually. It's not me. So really understanding that, because that influences the way these relationships, that influences the way that people work together, unfortunately, it influences who needs to be be a part of the process. Even organizations, the police organizations, have a long history, and those people have relationships that go back decades, people who went to high school with each other. And, you know, so-and-so's brother broke up with so-and-so's sister, and that is influencing the way that they work together today. And so I feel like that's a critical factor in understanding, as a researcher, how you work with people and listening to people and understanding those cues and so, some of the things that people say in passing or in jest that really will impact getting people together to have conversations about what is it that we do about this particular neighborhood or this particular crime problem or this particular person. So the benefit of working in some of the same cities over an extended period of time is knowing that and getting to know that so that you can use that in informing how you work together with people. And the same goes for the community. My parents grew up in Lowell, and some of the neighborhood people that I have met know my parents. And so understanding how people are connected, you know, is a really important factor in how I do my work and how I listen and ask people. I can't call this person, can you help me call this person? And I think that's been very helpful. But I've also learned what happens when you don't do that. And that can have a negative impact on the project work too. So that the contextual dynamics, both of the organization and of the community, are an important part of the partnership and of the research as well.
So we have one question here that was sent in, and I think we all know the issue of police accountability is huge in the news these days. We've talked a lot about using data to identify potential criminals, so on, but how about using data for police accountability, and where can that fit into this process?
So you're looking at me most certainly.
Yeah. Looking at you.
Don't worry.
If one of them want to bail you out, that's fine.
So no. And I'm not looking to be bailed out. So to be clear, there's nobody that is more committed to police accountability than the police commissioner himself and the mayor of the city of Boston, and frankly, the entire command staff. You can imagine it's a very vibrant conversation these days that we're having quite a bit. And I am excited also to report that no one is afraid of having the conversation. Many in the room probably saw the report issued by the ACLU, and having been part of those conversations with the mayor, the police commissioner, and the command staff, everyone is immediately excited about getting to work to look at the data behind that report and figure out what we can do better. Both of my colleagues really alluded to what I had said in my beginning comments, that if we don't make a commitment to looking at the root cause of the statistics, we just won't be successful. So when Chris asked that question to Cynthia, I think the real response to that is, look, we have to look at why it's happening, who's committing the crime, and what are the other factors that might contribute to some of that decision making. So in terms of using data for police accountability, the police commissioner and the mayor are excited about, we'll take the ACLU report, for example, looking at FIOs that many of you may have heard of, field interrogation and observation reports. So we want to, as a city, look at those FIOs aggressively. The most recent data that we had is the data that was referenced in that report. I think it was 2007 to 2010, so prior to this commissioner and this mayor, but we want to continue to figure out ways to look at that in real time as best that we can to make sure that we're not seeing trends that we shouldn't be seeing as a city, that we're making sure that the police have healthy relationships with our neighbors. It would take me too long to talk to you about the efforts of the Boston Police Department and the things that they are doing that no one hears about. I made that joke about law enforcement earlier, but without a doubt, we are not perfect. The police department needs to improve. But we have the best police department in the country, and they are more willing than any other law enforcement I've ever been around and traveled a bit in my capacity to be part of these difficult conversations. So I think data plays an absolute role in how we police and looking at police accountability.
Great. Brenda.
I would say, well, yes, we should hold the police accountable, first of all. But I think we need to be really clear and have ongoing conversations about the expectations that we have, and then have leadership that supports meeting those expectations. So one of the things I've been thinking about in all of the news and the discussions that have been occurring is sort of this idea of training and how much police need training. And training is probably one of the least funded activities in police agencies. For most police agencies, a very, very low percentage of their budget is dedicated to training. And most of what is required by state law is 40 hours of in-service training that primarily covers important constitutional updates, legal updates, and CPR recertification. Very little is dedicated to allowing officers to spend time with the community, hearing more about what their concerns are and those kinds of things. So I feel like we need to push police agencies towards building the capacity to keep the data so that they are held accountable. But on the other end of it, I think that we also need to think really hard about how agencies are resourced and what it is we expect for them, and making sure that there's a good fit between that. We need to have quick and certain punishment of officers who do the kinds of things that are not acceptable, and that needs to happen. But I think we should really rethink sort of what it is we expect, and then make sure that they're resourced in a way that helps them to achieve those expectations.
So we have time for three or four questions.
Hi, good morning. I'm Bill Gormley with Xconomy. The discussion so far, I'd say, is in the context of Boston and Massachusetts. And I think when you look at data sets for how ideas move in the United States, just to pick a very high generic, it's a system. And the Northeast Corridor appears to have a number of patterns, and very strong patterns related to, for instance, human trafficking, crime patterns, different substances that are moved around legally and illegally. Can you talk about the bigger system and how your research and your learning is applying to analyzing the whole system, especially the Northeast Corridor?
Sure. What was your name? I'm sorry?
Bill.
I'll give that a stab, and maybe my colleagues can also give that a stab. So recognizing from my past life and my current life, let's talk about firearm trafficking and some of the patterns of firearm trafficking, the drug trade, and human trafficking, and how it moves up and down the East Coast. Recognizing that it is crucial for us. Let's just talk about firearm trafficking. This year, to date, in the city of Boston, we've taken 1,020 guns off the street. So over 1,000 guns in the city of Boston. The next logical question that some of our community partners are talking about, and you're familiar with an agency called Lipstick, hopefully some of you are, where did the gun come from? So it forces the conversation to look at using data, say, where are those guns coming from? When I first started in this business, the majority of the guns were coming majority of crime guns are coming to Massachusetts from out of state. I'm not sure what the most recent statistic is, but I think we're about 50-50 for our crime guns arriving in the state of Massachusetts, some homegrown and the other 50%. But recognizing that that was a significant issue, the mayor, for the first time in my professional life, reached out to the mayors, the police chiefs, the town managers, the town selectmen of virtually every city in the Northeast Corridor. And that took place in April of this year to hold the first time ever a firearm trafficking summit to talk about how can we share information, how can we look at trends. In that room we had at Roxbury Community College, the mayor addressed, the police commissioner addressed,
Virtually the entire Boston Police Command staff was there with, I want to say it was 200 plus individuals representing Massachusetts and then up and down. I believe Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Hampshire, Maine, Vermont.
New York.
I'm not sure if New York was present. I would have to check my notes on that, but it created a wonderful dynamic about talking about a regional fusion center to track the firearms coming into our neighborhoods here in the city of Boston and how it impacted their respective community. And it was very transparent conversation. Many of the people in the room from Massachusetts said, look, we recognize maybe your guns are coming to our state, but we also recognize our drugs are potentially going to your state. And how do we work together to evaluate that problem? And so it's a crucial piece of the conversation. It is happening. We have federal partners. The ATF was in the room. I also believe the DEA was in the room. Representatives from the United States attorneys were in the room. The attorney generals were in the room. The respective district attorney's offices were in the room. So it's a conversation that we realize needs to continue to move forward.
Additional questions? Sure, please come up to the mic though. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Emily Dexter and I'm an educational researcher and community activist in Cambridge and I love data. This might be more for Brenda. I was thinking about what you'd done in Cambridge in terms of trying to use data to look at crime patterns. Wait, whoever does data work. And I was wondering, are there ways to link that data with educational data so that we can start to develop profiles of young people earlier in their life in terms of their educational life and really put in place the interventions that will keep them on a good path?
That would be really nice. So there's a major issue with data sharing, right? So I think that's probably a worse problem than having the analytical tools, right? So Dan Wagner keeps talking about that exact problem. You know, can you take that educational data, combine it with, say, you know, the police record? Can you use that to predict whether someone's going to commit? It would be nice. It would be nice.
So I guess I'd like to comment on that, which is, I think, you know, the potential there for linking across schools, police data, public health data, in terms of what we can learn both as researchers and policy analysts is enormous. And this is really a place where the mayor's office, I'm looking at Chris Osgood out there, really, you know, we need a lot of help. There's a lot, as Brenda has suggested, there's a lot of politics in these systems that has to be managed. And sharing data is sort of like a huge thing. It's, you know, they'd rather have you take their kid, I think, than take your data. You know, I think for the greater Boston area, you know, how much we achieve in the next decade in many respects is going to be a function of how much cooperation can we get to integrate data sources. Because, you know, the kid who the police department's worried about, the school department's worried about, the public health people are worried about, but they don't have that connection in the data. And obviously, kids, for instance, who have problems usually have lots of problems of different types that are all interconnected. So certainly want to make a plea here, though I know our friends in the mayor's office obviously understand that. Now, I think we had a question over here. Somebody had their, okay, right there. And then I, sure.
Hi, my name is Anise. How you doing? Thank you so much for your presentations. They were fantastic. I just wanted to ask a question on the police accountability conversation that we were having. I was wondering where in the city of Boston the conversation is at in terms of keeping records on incidents of police altercations and where the conversation is at on making those records public if and when they are kind of kept consistently. Thank you.
Sure, Anise, I'll give it a quick step. Did you mean when you say police altercations, did you mean if there's a civilian complaint against a police officer or an altercation where a police officer uses force?
An altercation where a police officer uses force, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Whether justified or not justified, just an incident of force, yeah.
Okay, so we have a internal affairs division on the Boston Police Department, so all of those records are kept and contained in a central location for our police department.
Yeah.
There's a superintendent that is in charge of that. I believe there's also a deputy superintendent there with assigned investigators, including sergeant and detective investigators, that have a responsibility to evaluate the complaints that come into the police department. I don't know if that is a helpful answer to you. In terms of making those records public, as you've probably heard quite a bit, anytime something is an open investigation, the information in that investigation would not be able to be turned over.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of amounts of complaints that are registered, I'm just assuming some other questions you might have. The number of internal affair complaints or excessive use force complaints against the police department. I don't know if those numbers are public, but I'm happy to exchange information with you offline, and I'd get an answer for you on that.